Professor West, I'd like to start off with you. What do you make of what Herman Cain said?
Well, one, I mean, black people have been working hard for decades. I think he needs to get off the symbolic crack pipe.
You watch black college students from around the country and white college students from around the country come to the South and be murdered fighting for the rights of African Americans. Do you regret sitting on those sidelines at that time?
He seems willing to say anything in order to curry white favor.
And Herman Cain is just the latest incarnation of what is totally false to the needs of our community and the needs of our nation. I think he's a bad apple.
He deflects the racism that is inherent in the Republican Party, the conservative movement. Let's get Herman Cain involved so it deflects the obvious racism of our Republican Party.
I've got a problem with somebody who doesn't mind moving to the back of the bus. I've got a problem with somebody who doesn't have a problem with that word. Well, controversy was right at Herman Cain's doorstep. And he did nothing.
The people that he needs to win over, those people do not want to hear from a black man who's aggressive, assertive, angry. They want to hear from a man who's assimilated, calm, measured.
I think Herman Cain is the Tea Party's black friend. You know, people say, yeah, I couldn't possibly be a racist. I have a black friend. I think he's their black friend.
No. Old Man River, that's what they walk away with. They walk away with a guy singing and saying what the right wing wants to hear.
I think he is giving that base a free pass.
Wow.
And I think they like him because they think he is a black man who knows his place. And I know that's harsh, but that's how it sure seems to me.
A black man who knows his place. The Tea Party's black friend doesn't mind moving to the back of the bus. A bad apple. Now, conservatives that are African-American have had to withstand. This is all before any charges of sexual harassment. This type of assault. And the question is, why do we allow this to go on if somebody has their own thought process and they think differently? Star Parker is with us, and we're honored to have her back. She's a columnist, president of CURE, and the author of Uncle Sam's Plantation, which I, by the way, endorse. Dr. Mark Lamont Hill is with us, Columbia University professor, host of Our World with Black Enterprise. Dr. Hill.
Are you honored to have me too, Sean?
Yeah, of course. I'm glad you're on the show.
Sure.
Thank you.
Just teasing you.
Here this happens again and again and again. Now, before we get to the specifics of the sexual harassment charge, this was said long before this. This is the lead up to this. And that is that conservative African-Americans are routinely, with regularity, called the most vile names and attacked and slandered and besmirched. Why?
Well, I don't know if he's been slandered and besmirched.
He's a black man that wants to move to the back of the bus. He's the Tea Party's black friend. He's a bad apple. You know, all these comments I just played for you. You don't find those vile and offensive?
Some I disagreed with.
I didn't ask if you disagreed. Do you find them offensive?
Some I did. Some I did not.
So you found some of those comments offensive. And does it happen with regularity conservative African-Americans are attacked for being conservative and routinely called vile names?
I think that conservatives in general are...
No, conservative, Uncle Tom, Oreo, sellout. We've heard these names.
I think that black conservatives are often attacked simply for being black conservatives. Yeah, I think that's problematic.
You think it's problematic? How very efficient of you. Go ahead.
I'm
sympathetic. I hear great sympathy in your voice.
I do sympathize. You know, I talk about this all the time. I have conservative black friends. Who I respect greatly. Michael Steele, I think, is a great guy. I won't call him a friend because I don't want to get him in trouble, but he's certainly a guy who I respect, and I've worked with him before, and I think that he's a decent person. And even though I think he's wrong on issues, it doesn't stop me from respecting him. But then there are people who are black conservatives who, quite frankly, I believe are black conservatives because the line is shorter. And when I talk to them when the cameras are off or when I talk to them when no one is looking, Sean, what they say basically is, I don't care about this conservative or liberal stuff. I just want to be on TV or I just want to get a spot on the ticket. And by being a black conservative, it'll play to white audiences. And that's what people are skeptical of with Herman Cain. Now, I happen to think that Herman Cain really believes everything that he says. I think he's a dyed-in-the-wool conservative. I think he has values that he thinks are real and true and right. At the same time, he does do things in public that make me very uncomfortable.
Star Parker, let me ask you the names you've been called in your life.
Well, I can't say them in public and on air, and not to mention the death threats that I get on a very regular basis, and actually have had to hire extra help in my office just to make sure that my secretary and her innocent ears and eyes are not offended by the slander that comes through. But let's take it to a deeper question, Sean. During slavery, any time somebody decided that they were going to listen to the abolitionist call and that they were going to run away, they would get away, and then even up until the time they passed the Fugitive Slave Law, if an overseer found a black runaway, they would bring them back to the plantation. Then they would call all the other slaves out and make them watch that slave's skin be stripped from him so that nobody else would talk about freedom. And this is the environment that we now have with these black overseers who dare any conservative and or someone who's thinking about being conservative to not speak publicly. What we have now is a community of African Americans that they themselves are questioning the principles of this administration, the platform of this administration when it comes to pro-life and other deeper social and moral questions, but also the policies of this administration that have created this environment to where their unemployment rates are twice that of the general population. But
okay,
dare they say it in public? The reason they cannot say it in public is because this is what happens when one starts to say publicly, maybe we should rethink our place in this great nation and in our history. Herman Cain was in high school during the Civil Rights Movement. See, they forgot to say that when they're slandering him and his family's position to say, you children stay in school and mind your studies while we allow a movement to grow. We don't know whether his parents and other relatives were even engaged. We just know he was in high school. He decided to run. He was not recruited by the Republican Party. In fact, the Republican Party during the primaries doesn't recruit. They might give a nod and a nudge right. some places, or they might align themselves behind people that have a lot of resources. But the venom that comes out of these African, and they let these white masters get away with this venom themselves. What? By giving them a pass when they defame somebody's person just because they simply disagree on policy issues has got to be challenged. So I thank you that you're challenging it, and you're challenging the left that keep supporting these ideas that anytime anyone disagrees with them, they can go after their person, they can steal away their character, they can basically lynch them, as Herman Cain and Clarence Thomas have pointed out.
Oh, my God.
You want to respond?
Yeah, to a few of those points. One, I think it's problematic to equate a critique of Herman Cain to lynching in the same way that, I think that's a bit of an over. I don't think he's being lynched right now. I think what he's doing, as all presidential candidates have done, is he's being analyzed and scrutinized. Rick Perry was scrutinized a few weeks ago in similar fashion. We saw Mitt Romney scrutinized, John McCain scrutinized, Barack Obama scrutinized, black and white candidates get scrutinized, and I don't believe that he's being lynched because people have the audacity to challenge him.
Well, can I just add one point on that? I think this is important. Obama started his political career in Bill Ayer's house, sat on boards with him, gave speeches with him. Do you know, Dr. Hill, how many questions he was asked about Bill Ayers during the campaign? How many questions?
What I'd like to do, Sean, is be able to.
Can you answer? You just said Obama was scrutinized.
Uninterrupted. I haven't even been able to finish one.
I'm asking you. I'll give you your time. Answer my. Do you know the answer to that question? How many times was he asked?
I don't know the answer to
that question. All right. One time. Do you think that scrutiny, the same level of scrutiny that Herman Cain is getting? No, it's not. So there is a double standard if you're a liberal versus if you're a conservative, which is my point. But go ahead. I'll let you finish your point.
Yeah, I disagree with everything you just said, but what you're doing is...
doesn't matter.
Red
you
herring.
Can't. I'm throwing a fact out. Here the president... Here the candidate, Obama, hung out with an unrepentant terrorist, and nobody asked him about it. One time.
Sean, just because you talk really loud and say that Barack Obama got more scrutiny than... got less scrutiny than Herman Cain,
less, that's correct. No, it's a fact. Don't you think that the media should have asked him about his relationship with Bill Ayers a little more? Don't you think so?
No, I'd like...
No, you don't think so. You do think so or you don't?
Sean, I'm trying to talk about Herman Cain, and you keep trying to talk about Bill Ayers.
Yeah, because you said that there was the same scrutiny for Obama, and what you said was false,
Sean,
and I'm straightening you out and telling you the truth.
Sean, you haven't let me say anything. What you've done is let Star Talk uninterrupted, and every sentence I make, you interrupt, and we go into a...
No, when you got that quote wrong,
Sean,
when you said something that's factually inaccurate, I'm going to call you out on it.
But I didn't finish the thought, Sean. I didn't say anything.
You said Obama got the same scrutiny, and I'm saying I disagree.
Okay, you disagree. You registered your disagreement. Now may I finish?
Go ahead.
What I actually said is that all presidential candidates get intense scrutiny.
Except Obama.
Fine, Sean. Barack Obama didn't get scrutiny. No one scrutinized Jeremiah Wright. Fox News didn't run deep analysis of
I did.
For months. Yes, you did, Sean. And I
did a lot of good work.
And, Sean, I saw you at the Democratic Convention in 2008, and the first thing you said to me is, this guy won. I can't believe he won, despite the fact that I spent every night talking about this.
No, that's not what I said to you. That's absolutely not what I said to you. I said people fell in many ways. I think the American people gave Barack Obama a pass because they were caught up in what I define as Obama mania. I think.
Let me interject something there as well, because it wasn't just Obama mania. Because
before you jump in, please let me finish. What I'm saying, my point to you, Sean, and what you said to me publicly. You said this behind the scenes. And what you said to me publicly on the air was that despite all the evidence of Jeremiah Wright and blah, 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 my point being that there clearly was intense scrutiny about Jeremiah Wright. There was clearly intense scrutiny.
Not by the mainstream media, making a distinction.
Okay, now can I talk about Herman Cain? Now that we've done all of that, now can I talk about Herman Cain?
Yeah, 30 seconds. Go.
Herman Cain. You know what, Sean? You can have the 30 seconds. I'm going to go.
Oh, stop it. I'm messing with you. Just go. Just stop
being. I'm yielding at the star.
No, he's giving it to me. I'll take it.
I'm yielding at the star.
No, just say let him say what he wants, star. He's going to complain. Go ahead.
Well, you just talked about it. The mainstream media, had they scrutinized this
current president?
Because
Sean's not the mainstream media. Sean, you have 2.5 million viewers. You're not the mainstream media?
Right. 2.5 in a country of 300 million. For you to pretend that there's not a steady flow of a liberal diet in media, especially into these harder hit communities, you're fooling yourselves. No, would to God that Fox got the same platform that the rest of these networks combined get, that we hear endlessly their left-wing agenda, and yet there's no counter to that. Very few voices. And even when you have one network like a Fox, the president himself demeans their legitimacy in the court. From the press room of all places.
Okay.
Not a bias. But at the end of the day, Herman Cain will override this the same way those that wanted the desired freedom, as Frederick Douglass said, he would die seeking freedom. And there will come a point that others will begin to. In fact, that's, I think, why Herman Cain is under such a magnifying glass at this moment. It's not the white Republicans that are following him.
He's under a magnifying glass because. Hold on. Let me jump in one second.
All right, Star, give him a chance because he's.
Herman Cain is under the magnifying glass because he's winning. No one noticed Herman Cain when he was losing because he wasn't a factor. Now that Herman Cain is winning and people think he's viable, he's getting more media attention. He's getting it from the left, and he's getting it from the right. Do I think Herman Cain should be called an Uncle Tom? Do I think Herman Cain should be beaten up and talked about in the media rhetorically? No, I don't think he deserves that. I think that's unfair, and I think that does happen to black conservatives. I conceded that point from the beginning. I think black conservatives are often treated unfairly. But I think some of what Herman Cain is getting right now, he's getting not just because he's a black conservative, but because he's doing certain things that speak to people's racial sensibilities. Like, for example, singing Negro spirituals at the National Press Club. When you do that, you're going to expect some people to say, wait a minute.
No, you expect liberals to do that because liberals don't want black people to be free. So liberals, anytime they hear a conservative, they act like a conservative
is
not legitimate if they are African American to adopt their black heritage. You know, let me.
I'm calling you. It's factually inaccurate. This is what I'm saying.
At the end of the day, if you can listen to that opening that Sean played and not be deeply offended, I don't care who it was.
Here's what I'm deeply offended by.
Relentless stuff, and you blacks would sit there and smile at that type of
venom coming from
their mouth. That is
a filibustering right now. No, that's not it. This is what the issue is. The issue isn't about black conservatives and being a black conservative. The issue here is, again, particular choices that Herman Cain has made on the campaign trail that does arouse certain people's sensibilities. It's not, and as a black leftist, I'm telling you that I don't have a problem with Michael Steele. I don't have a problem with Alan West.
Yeah, so liberals get to decide which black they want.
No,
if you can listen to the
no.
Sean, you should play that again. Because
no, that's not You keep cutting me off. You all would just listen. You would hear what I'm saying. I'm not saying that I pick and choose. What I'm saying is that there are certain people who I don't have an issue with because I don't have a problem with black conservatives. I have an issue with people who do certain things, whether you're black.
I got one conservative friend. I got one. I like that one.
That's not what I'm saying.
So that one gets the public scrutiny and the left-wing liberal in their press
Let me help
both of you out here. Have you heard, for example, Star, have you heard the term Uncle Tom? Have you had the, Uncle Tom, sellout, Oreo. Have you heard all these terms regularly used?
Absolutely.
Have you? All right,
time.
Now.
And not just that.
And Dr. Hill, have you heard them?
Your own tape?
I can't hear you two. You're both talking over me.
Dr. Hill, have you heard those terms a lot?
Have I heard what terms?
Terms like sellout, Uncle Tom, or you've heard it a lot. Isn't that the most offensive thing you can say?
No, I've been called worse. Sean. In fact, every time I get off of your radio show, I get letters from black and white people that use the N-word. They call me Uncle Tom. They call me all sorts of things.
I look. First of all, that is not the main core of my audience that does that. I'll tell you what. You want to talk more. We got to take a break. We'll come back. We'll continue more with Star Parker and Dr. Mark Lamont Hill. I mean, you're continuing with Dr. Mark Lamont Hill and Star Parker. Let me go back and play this again, this montage, and I want both of you to pay very close attention to it. This was all said about Herman Cain prior to the allegations that came up about sexual harassment. And the question I want you to think of is why are so many people on the left threatened by Herman Cain as a conservative?
Professor West, I'd like to start off with you. What do you make of what Herman Cain said?
Well, one, I mean, black people have been working hard for decades. I think he needs to get off the symbolic crack pipe.
You watch black college students from around the country and white college students from around the country come to the South and be murdered fighting for the rights of African Americans. Do you regret sitting on those sidelines at that time?
He seems willing to say anything in order to curry white favor.
And Herman Cain is just the latest incarnation of what is totally false to the needs of our community and the needs of our nation. I think he's a bad apple.
He deflects the racism that is inherent in the Republican Party, the conservative movement. Let's get Herman Cain involved so it deflects the obvious racism of our Republican Party.
I've got a problem with somebody who doesn't mind moving to the back of the bus. I've got a problem with somebody who doesn't have a problem with that word. Well, controversy was right at Herman Cain's doorstep. And he did nothing.
The people that he needs to win over, those people do not want to hear from a black man who's aggressive, assertive, angry. They want to hear from a man who's assimilated, calm, measured.
I think Herman Cain is the Tea Party's black friend. You know, people say, yeah, I couldn't possibly be a racist. I have a black friend. I think he's their black friend.
No. Old Man River, that's what they walk away with. They walk away with a guy singing and saying what the right wing wants to hear.
I think he is giving that base a free pass.
Wow.
And I think they like him because they think he is a black man who knows his place. And I know that's harsh, but that's how it sure seems to me.
All right. Dr. Hill, again, some of the most offensive terminology is used in society about conservative African Americans. And I want to know, would this be tolerated if he were not a conservative? I think the answer is obviously no.
Again, I think that black conservatives get certainly a tougher road in the public sphere from black folk in particular. I think that it becomes a space where black people can, you know, call someone a Tom or say that someone is not racially authentic because they have different beliefs. And I think there's some degree of irony to that because oftentimes the beliefs of the black conservative aren't that different than the Democratic voting African-American who may be socially conservative but still aligned to the Democratic Party. So to that extent, I think it's really interesting and tricky. But I'd like to very quickly, without interruption, just return to this point because something was said that wasn't true. I'm not saying that I pick and choose which conservatives I like or dislike arbitrarily. Like any voter, like any smart citizen, what I do is I listen to what people say, I listen to people's policies, I watch people's behavior, and I make decisions about who I want to support and who I don't want to support. I'm not going to support a black conservative just because he's black, nor because he's conservative. Similarly, I don't support all black liberals or even more to the left than that. So that, to me, is the issue. My issue, so when I talk about Herman Cain, I'm not criticizing Herman Cain for being a black conservative, even if I disagree with him. There are many black conservatives who I disagree with, but who I don't have these critiques of. It's the fact, again, that he seems to be at his best. He seems to be most comfortable. Herman Cain is most comfortable when he is entertaining white people at the national press.
Most comfortable entertaining white people.
Yes. When he is saying and doing things that make white voters and particularly white conservatives comfortable, and that's what people mean.
Most comfortable entertaining white people. How insulting is that?
You know what? He's running for the nomination
for
the Republican. Okay, now my turn for the Republican Party.
You're out of time. I've been incredibly rude this entire interview, interrupting you.
Of course, much of the audience at this point are Caucasian. But let's get to what you just played. Okay, sitting on the sidelines during civil rights, will say anything to appease them, must like the back of the bus, knows his place. No, what makes liberals angry and why they destroy the messenger rather than the debate, the message, is because the answers that Herman Cain is bringing forth are the very answers that will heal the black community. So what they want to do is destroy him as a messenger so that black folks won't hear. See, right now, President Obama has a problem. He is falling in the polls with African Americans in this country. And some of the states, the margin is so thin. North Carolina, they can't afford for one to leave. Georgia, these margins are Colorado.
Virginia, New Mexico, Nevada.
No, New Mexico, not as much, but Ohio, right. Nevada, yes. They, believe it or not, they have very large population of African Americans, including an African American state senator who gets no play from the left because he's a conservative and he's a Republican, and they've had him in there for years. But that's not the point. The point is the ideas that Herman is bringing forth will destroy liberalism in this country. Herman Cain is for educational choice, and so are African Americans polling up their fourth choice. So they got to make sure that he doesn't talk about education. Instead, he has to address whether he wants to sit in the back of the bus. Herman Cain in health care is for portability. He wants people to be able to go where they want to. Medicaid is a disaster. It already takes care of most of our poor, and they need mobility. They can't even get doctors. 50% of doctors in this country won't even take Medicaid.
Let me ask you this.
The same rhetoric of the left that keeps destroying the messengers so that these folks will live like people in Venezuela or Cuba.
Hey, Star, what do you think about what Dr. Hill just said, that he's most comfortable entertaining, what did you say, white people?
I may have said white folk, but either white people, white folk, whichever.
Well, white folks, yeah, that's what he said, and he calls it entertainment. This in itself, in the rhetoric, is to delegitimize.
Wait, let her answer.
The man is running for the president of the United States of America for the Republican nomination, and that those
but
words.
But isn't that just as insulting?
He's not pandering to or he's running for president. He should be comfortable with all Americans.
The man is singing Negro spirituals at the National Press Club. What presidential candidate in the history of America?
Yours sat down and played guitar for us. Come on, you're forgetting that Bill Clinton.
He sat down
and wanting to singing and dancing, and in fact, a hooping and a hollering, they named him the first black president. The man is a preacher. Of course he sings. What, are you offended that he would sing a spiritual, a Negro spiritual? You know, he really is black and from the South, so he probably knows them better than you since you're Ivy League trained. He probably knows a whole lot more about black history than you because he's from it, he's lived it, and his parents told him to stay focused on your studies while we're moving through this civil rights era. His parents weren't the only parents. A lot of parents encouraged their children to go to school because they believe that they had already won that civil rights movement and they wanted their children to aspire educationally.
Hold on. No, you're completely going off on a tangent. I never said anything about him knowing history or anything, or his parents encouraging him to go to school. My issue isn't him knowing spirituals or singing. I love this.
We're talking about you personally. We're talking about all this rhetoric about sitting on the sidelines doing so. He was in high school. They forgot to say that he was in high school.
Can I just finish my sentence?
Back of the bus. I can't believe you let white folks get away with saying this kind of stuff and not be offended. You should be calling them to the side and saying, excuse me.
Can I just finish?
We want to have dialogue in this country. We don't need you all to pull out stereotypical language so that you can racially divide this country in the state that we're in today. This is not what we should be doing with our country. What we need to do is find ourselves and get back to our constitutional heritage and start living as free people. This is demeaning what they're doing. They're just jealous because the Republican Party and people in the Republican Party.
Right, let me jump in here and play something. You're offended that he sang, which, by the way, he does sing in church and he's got a beautiful voice. What about when Hillary Clinton goes before predominantly African-American audiences and, let's just say her tone and cadence change dramatically?
I don't. don't feel no ways tired. I come too far from where I started from. Nobody told me that the road would be easy. I don't believe he brought me this far to leave me. And the chair of all the mayors in the country, Mayor Palmer from Trenton, New Jersey.
I hope I get an opportunity to answer this. Hello?
Yeah, you're on. Go ahead.
Oh, okay, because I know as soon as I start talking, you're going to interrupt, but I think what Hillary Clinton did right there is the exact thing that I'm critiquing Herman Cain for. She's sitting there trying to entertain black audiences in churches. It's insulting. It's patronizing. It's condescending. And when she did it, and you asked me about it 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I told you then that I thought it was offensive.
Well, what's the difference? But the difference, well, here's the difference.
If what you're saying was consistent, then no, he would have got up and sang a different song. He would not have chosen a Negro spirit. He would have chose Dixieland or something crazy.
I mean, that's what she did. No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that what Hillary Clinton did is wrong, and I'm saying what Herman Cain is wrong.
He sang a song of his heritage. Actually, I thought it was kind of cool. The same way that, because it opens up the door for people to say, well, I've not heard that one before. Actually, it should be, you liberals should be happy. It's diversity. He's actually doing the black diversity. History that you've been
forcing
down.
All right, now, wait a minute. Now, as long as we're going to go through the golden oldies here. We've got Al Gore. Now, we did add some music to it because he goes before a predominantly African-American audience, and then he changed, too.
And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed. Stand with me for the economic empowerment that is the next great civil rights frontier. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed. Don't tell me we live in a colorblind society. The Republicans know that theirs is the wrong agenda for African Americans. That's why they don't even want to count you in the census.
All right, that's enough for now. The Republicans don't even want to count.
Sean, this doesn't make sense. Sean, your argument isn't making sense.
No, the argument makes perfect sense.
No. It only makes sense if I were saying one is right and one is wrong. I agree with those two clips are doing the same thing that I'm accusing Herman Cain of, and I'm saying
Herman Cain.
No,
the difference is being himself. Herman Cain is not changing. That's him.
That's right. That's who he is. He would be changing if he got up and sang some country western.
Here's the point, though. Here's the point. Both of them are attempting to pander to voters, right? Herman Cain might be drawing from his own culture or tradition to pander to voters, but he doesn't walk around. And I'm sure when he's the CEO of Godfather Pizza, he's not walking around singing Negro spirituals at the board meetings. But he understands that vote.
I hate to tell you this because I've been on stage with Herman.
And if he is,
hang on a second. Oh. And Herman. People ask him, he's a radio host in Atlanta, ask him to sing all the time because everyone knows he has a beautiful voice and he's a great singer.
Yes.
I mean, that is quintessentially Herman.
Sean, he might be a great tap dancer too, but I don't want him.
Now, that's insulting. Mark, you're getting more insulting by the minute, more comfortable entertaining white folk. What is wrong with you?
Sean, what's wrong with me? The guy scratches when he doesn't itch and he laughs when he's not tickled.
I'm going to have to go, guys, because it doesn't seem we're getting anywhere except to point out to your listeners that there is a double standard. But what the biggest fear of the Democrats,
standard.
I think one of the biggest fears of the Democrats is that the likelihood of Herman Cain winning this nomination, and then they have to sit there and support Barack Obama against someone as articulate and as smart and as well thought as a Herman Cain. This they were not expecting. They wanted someone like a Sarah Palin, who they did everything they could to destroy her integrity and her family. They want somebody that they know that they might not be able to win, because in these marginal states, you have now African Americans who are desperate to find some type of economic stability.
Right, we're just running out of time, Star. I got to cut you short.